Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. Well, we're cornerback intensive tonight, and we're going to start out with Willie Brown, not the politician, but the great Oakland Raiders cornerback who died recently at the age of 78. What a player Willie Brown was. One of the greatest Oakland Raiders of all time, one of the greatest cornerbacks of all time, a Hall of Famer who's frequently mentioned as one of the 100 greatest players in NFL history. Besides that, Willie Brown was atypical for the Oakland Raiders of the 1970s and 80s because he was a gentleman. He wasn't a headhunter or a dirty player like some of the Raiders were. He came out of Grambling and people didn't think he had the skills for the NFL, but boy were they wrong. His skills as a cornerback were probably the equal of just about anybody in NFL history. And the guys who saw that were Al Davis and John Madden. Here is Mercury Morris, Miami Dolphins great of the 70s, who faced off against Willie Brown many times to talk about the legend.
When you look back and you say to yourself, well, what team gave you the most problem? Well, the Oakland Raiders. What player on that team gave you the most problems? And it would be Willie Brown. Willie Brown, I can see him now ending our run. 1970 in the playoffs. I see him now intercepting that ball and ending our hopes. So Willie Brown kind of let us know that from 1970 on, like, hey, pal, by and large, this is how it's going to be. You make a mistake and you're going to pay.
Cornerback Willie Brown was a college linebacker who went undrafted in 1963. When he joined the AFL's Denver Broncos, he helped revolutionize bump and run coverage.
I got directly in front of the receiver. And I said, well, if I knock him down to get my hands on him, I knew that there's no place for him to go. So I tried it, and it worked out for me fine.
He was a ball hawk that would disrupt the things that you were trying to get accomplished.
Brown playing up nose to nose with Snow. Back goes Gabe to pass. He looks, sets up, he's in trouble, runs to the left, throws on the move.
He was so good that, forget about it, he was going to cover somebody like a blanket.
Brown intercepted 54 passes in his 16-year career. Though he spent 12 years in Oakland, he didn't fit the mold of the typical Raider.
He came from the old school. He wasn't flashy. He didn't talk a lot of smack, which a lot of Raiders did back then, Atkinson and Tatum and those guys. You respected the guy because he was a good guy. As a matter of fact, 1973, I went to the Pro Bowl and Willie had those black Raider armbands. And I said, Willie, you have those armbands. He said, there you go. And I wore them the rest of my career. And the guy says, why do you switch to those in armbands? I said, man, I got these from Willie Brown.
Brown not only influenced styles, but also influenced the outcomes of some of the Raiders' biggest wins.
Bradshaw sets up and lobs one out to the left.
Brown had 7 career postseason interceptions, including 3 returned for touchdowns.
And he looks and throws. Intercepted by the Oakland Raiders. Willie Brown at the 30, 40, 50. He's going all the way. Old man Willie, touchdown Raiders.
That's what you remember about Willie Brown the most, is the big play. And you know what? I can't get this out of my mind. Since I've been talking to you, I've seen it about 5 or 6 times. Him intercepting that ball and running it back against us in 1970. He was always there in the big play.
Well, that last call of Old Man Willie is one of the iconic plays in NFL history. It was Super Bowl XI. The Raiders were up over the Vikings 25-14 with about 6.5 minutes to go, but the Vikings were driving. Fran Tarkenton had them on the move in Oakland territory for a touchdown that could make it a 4-point game when Willie Brown intercepted a flat pass to Sammy White. Here's the call from Kurt Gowdy and Dandy Don Meredith.
Filippiano and Tarkenton said, let's get up there and get moving now.
Right.
We're down to 6 minutes to play.
He zipped that one pretty good down into that middle zone. That's what they're playing. Had Rashad coming back across the middle, threaded it right between a couple of linebackers and hit him right in the numbers. There's another little quick flip. Look out.
There he goes.
Goodbye.
Hand off. Willie Brown on
Goodbye.
Willie Brown, the veteran. He waited for that one. 14 years Willie waited, and he scored a Super Bowl touchdown. Look at the Raiders come on the field. The whole squad is going over there.
Well, they love Willie. He's been there for a long time.
Look at him mobbing.
You're right. He sat back. They were waiting for that little dig out to the outside, trying to look at that guy, Willie Brown.
He's a defensive captain, all pro many times. He has been better this year than he's been the last 2 or 3 years. and 14 years. Watch him grab this one.
Well, it was almost picked off by Hendricks before he got out to Brown. He was trying to hit Semi White on a little quick square out. There's nothing to it. No fun race there. That's Brown made a little move after him.
Willie Brown has scored a 75-yard touchdown.
As I said, one of the iconic plays in NFL history. Well, we're going to move on now to another NFL cornerback, Bernie Parrish, who died recently at the age of 83. Not quite the player Willie Brown was, but an excellent player for the Cleveland Browns. He was an All-Pro and a member of their 1964 NFL Championship team, the last championship that the Browns have won. He was also a little more prickly personality than Willie Brown because he became an advocate for a union for the NFL players in the late 1960s, which hurt his career. According to Cleveland.com, Bernie Parrish, who played 8 years for the Browns and was an advocate for NFL player rights even in retirement, died at the age of 83. Parrish was a two-time Pro Bowl cornerback with the Browns in the early 1960s. He was a Sporting News and an AP All-Pro in 1964 when he had 4 interceptions, including one for a touchdown. The Browns won the NFL title that year, and Parrish served as player coach, calling out defensive signals in the Browns' 27-0 win against the Colts. Parrish was the Browns NFL Players Association representative during his career and was vice president of the NFLPA from 1962 to 1965. Parrish fought with then-commissioner Pete Rozelle over player pensions and even called for Rozelle to be replaced with Paul Brown. After retiring in 1967, Parrish tried to organize a Teamsters-affiliated players union for the NFL-AFL. Later in life, Parrish continued to push for player rights. He lobbied for better pensions and licensing fees for players. In 2010, he testified to the House Judiciary Committee about the NFL's handling of player brain injuries. In 2012, he filed a lawsuit accusing the NFL of negligence in handling concussions. Parrish, who felt that he suffered from football-related cognitive issues, eventually received an undisclosed settlement, according to the New York Times. Parrish was inducted into the Cleveland Browns Legends program in 2017. I got to tell you, Bernie Parrish was a good player and a brave guy. You take on Pete Rozelle in the mid-60s, that's going to be the end of your career for sure. Well, we're going to move on now to John Conyers, who died recently at the age of 90. John Conyers was a member of the House of Representatives for nearly 50 years from Detroit. He was the longest-serving African-American in the House of Representatives and the 6th longest member serving overall. He was a longtime member of the House Judiciary Committee, which meant he was involved in the impeachment hearings on Richard Nixon, who didn't get impeached, and he was also involved in the impeachment hearings on Bill Clinton, who did get impeached. He also heard Bernie Parrish's testimony in front of the Judiciary Committee, a little bit symmetry there. But his most significant accomplishment was probably getting Martin Luther King's birthday made a national holiday. Martin Luther King made a significant contribution to John Conyers' campaign by supporting him when he first ran for the House of Representatives in the mid-1960s. Here's Fox News on the death of John Conyers.
Former Michigan Congressman John Conyers, Jr. has died. He was 90 years old. Conyers served in Congress for more than 50 years. He represented Detroit and some of the surrounding communities. And you know, that made him the 6th longest-serving member of Congress in history and the longest-serving African-American member of Congress. During his decades-long career, Conyers voted for the Articles of Impeachment against President Richard Nixon. He sponsored a bill to declare Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday a national holiday, and he hired civil rights icon Rosa Parks to serve on his staff in his Detroit office. She worked for him for more than 20 years. Conyers resigned in 2017 following allegations of sexual harassment, which he denied. You know, he supported a variety of liberal causes through the years. He was an Army veteran. He served in Korea. John Conyers, a crusading congressman for many decades.
Remember how recently liberal NPR mentioned conservative Harold Bloom's sexual harassment issue with Naomi Wolf? Well, here, conservative Fox News mentions John Conyers' sexual harassment issue, even though, again, it may not be germane to the story. So both sides do the same thing. Here's John Conyers talking about his early career.
And the one thing I'm very proud of, that I prize very highly, I got the endorsement of Martin Luther King, who normally did not endorse candidates, but I had been going south. I knew him. I had already met Rosa Parks, his Coretta Scott King family. He had 3 nephews on Van Dyke on the east side of Detroit who were either nephews or cousins. They were all urging that he endorse me. So when he came to Central Methodist Church for his usual Good Friday address, he did came out and supported me, which I was very proud of, and which I think contributed to my victory primarily. Rosa Parks had then left Alabama. She was up working in my campaign, and she had approached Dr. King too. So Coretta Scott King, when she was writing her biography, she called to confirm it because she had heard that I had received the endorsement, but she also knew that Dr. King stayed out of political activity because of the nature of the civil rights movement that he was leading. So that began my career. Now, I should tell you that I went to the Speaker of the House, John W. McCormick of Massachusetts, and urged him to have me appointed to the House Judiciary Committee on the basis that there had never been an African-American on that committee. After a number of interviews, that was exactly what happened.
Well, we're going to close tonight with Robert Evans, who died recently at the age of 89, one of the most flamboyant characters in Hollywood. He was born Robert Shapera, a nice Jewish boy from New York City. There you go, Elliot. And he became one of the most successful producers in Hollywood. The movies he produced took Paramount from the brink of bankruptcy to the most successful studio in Hollywood in the 70s. His autobiography, The Kid Stays in the Picture, which is what Daryl Zanuck said when everybody, including Ernest Hemingway, wanted him replaced as a middling actor on the set of The Sun Also Rises, was made into a movie, and he had his ups and downs with women and drugs in Hollywood. IMDb describes his career thusly. He began his show business career as a teenage radio act. After flopping in his first attempt at movie acting, he took a job promoting sales of lady slacks for Evan Picon, the clothing company founded and run by his brother. Some years later, Norma Shearer spotted him hanging around the pool at the Beverly Hills Hotel. She successfully touted him for the role of Irving Thalberg in Man of a Thousand Faces in 1957. Irving Thalberg had been Norma Shearer's husband. In a New York nightclub, Evans also caught the eye of Daryl Zanuck, who cast him as a bullfighter in The Sun Also Rises in 1957. But by the end of the 50s, Evans writes, "I was sure of one thing. I was a half-assed actor." He was determined to recast himself as a producer. Before launching his first picture, though, he was hired by Charlie Bloodhorn, head of the Gulf and Western conglomerate, as part of the shakeup at Paramount Pictures. Within months, Evans was head of production. In the late 1960s and early 70s, he became the quintessential new Hollywood executive with slickly packaged productions like Rosemary's Baby in 1968, Love Story in 1970, and The Godfather in 1972, which revived Paramount. The latter film in Chinatown in 1974 are the artistic highlights of Evans' Paramount career, though the amount of credit he deserves for them has been debated for decades. Eased out of Paramount, he saw The Cotton Club in 1984 turn from a musical godfather into a fiasco of front-page proportions. Evans righted his career with a new Paramount deal in the 1990s, with his last producing credit having been on the blockbuster romance comedy How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days in 2003. He was a great-looking guy, always had a good-looking woman on his arm. Wives included Phyllis George and Allie McGraw. His mansion in Beverly Hills was a meeting place for the rich and powerful. He used to play tennis with Jimmy Connors. Henry Kissinger was one of his buddies. But he also developed a typical Hollywood cocaine problem in the 1980s. He was implicated in the murder of a theatrical impresario on the set of The Cotton Club, but nothing was ever proven. Among Evans' other friends were Greg Bowser, a big-time Hollywood lawyer fixer, and Sidney Korshak, who, well, let's just say he represented another side of Hollywood. Evans was incredibly successful at Paramount. He was finally the victim of jealousy from other producers. There's a lot of razzle-dazzle in his life, and a lot of tragedy, too. Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT genius, Sid Tapps. As I said, Robert Evans was known for a lot of things, including his womanizing. He was married 7 times, and that doesn't count all his other paramours. It's said that his butler used to bring him his morning coffee with the name of the girl who was upstairs in the bedroom in case he forgot. His first wife was only 17 when he married her, and his last wife was 33 years younger than him. So as a final tribute to Robert Evans, we're going to play a big hit from 1968, around the time he started cavorting with Allie McGraw, who eventually became his third wife.